Good morning. So good to see you. The Lord Almighty is with us, so says Psalm 46, the God of Jacob, and he's our fortress, and we've come to worship him. Amen? Would you stand with me as we begin our time with him? Father, we love you this morning. We thank you for your invitation to be in your presence. You've called us to worship. And Lord, help our whole being to be involved, our minds, our hearts, be open to you. And Lord, speak to us today as only you can. We want to know you more, and we want to be like your son, Jesus. In your name we pray, amen. Let's lift up this beautiful hymn together. A mighty fortress is our God.
And his fortress is mighty. Amen?
Amen.
My name is Mark, and it's great to be with you today as we worship. This is a special day. As you leave today, you're going to hear a little bit later, there's ice cream sundaes and all sorts of fun stuff, ministry fair. Find out how you can be involved in the church. We're going to have a service here that's a bit different as well. In a minute, I'm going to invite Kyle Whipple to join me up front, and we're going to explain this piece of paper that you have in front of you. This is a great day as we gather back together. But as we begin the service, I just want us to respond in worship through this responsive reading together. So these words are going to be up on the screen. Let's say these together, and then we'll sing another great song. We come to worship God who has made us and knows us. We come to follow Jesus, who leads us to new life.
We come with joy, knowing in Christ we have eternal life.
And we come to listen to the Holy Spirit, who calls us forth.
We
enter this worship, knowing the Spirit is alive among us.
Amen.
Let's continue to sing. Psalm 100 tells us that the Lord is good, His love endures forever, and His faithfulness continues through all generations. If I didn't say before, my name is Mark Fuller, and this is Kyle Whipple, who most of you know, and we're going to just share some stuff with you this morning that I think is really exciting. I couldn't believe, just thinking back, June this year was 18 years for me here at this church as pastor, and So 1987, I would never have dreamed when my wife and I were just dating and my father-in-law invited us to come to this crazy church in Plymouth, Michigan, and we sat in this room as college students with no carpet on the floor. These walls would close off. These curtains, you may not have noticed that they're there, they would close off after the service and they'd have Sunday school classes. Never would have dreamed that multiple years later, God would call me back here as a pastor. I never thought I'd even be a pastor. That's insane to think of that. And to know that God has been faithful to me through all those generations, from me as a college student to coming here Having my wife's grandfather sit with us at worship every Sunday until he was 101. Seeing my kids grow up in our children's ministry, then in our teen ministry, continue to be part. Our youngest, who's back in the area, is a small group leader for our teens. And just to know that God has been faithful to me through all these generations, I never would have guessed how that would play out. And we're at this point of a church, as we've come out of COVID, where we're a growing church. I don't know if you realize that, but we have lots of new folks, lots of folks who are growing in their faith. And this is a fun time to be pastor of this church. And as we've seen, as a group of elders and leaders, seen this way that God has moved in our church to see what he's done in our children's ministry, our youth ministry, they're bursting at the seams. So many people opening up God's word, learning together, growing together in their faith, part of groups. Our worship services, I think, are fantastic. We're at this place where we're at the cusp of new growth and following God and his vision for us into the future. And one of the things that, as our group of elders have gathered together over the last couple years, we've unveiled this idea of a high five. How do we measure success for us? In the last 4 weeks, we've been in a sermon series, if you haven't been here, just explaining the first four of those high five, the idea of being a community where we're celebrating salvation all the time, seeing people come to know Jesus, and then discipling people and having a discipleship culture where we're gathering in groups and we're opening up scripture together and we're hearing what God has to say and we're listening and following what Jesus has for us. A church that's mission-minded, a church that's cross-generational. Because of the cross of Jesus, we gather together, whether you're 9 years old or 90 years old, and we try to learn from one another and grow together. And the last of those high five we've called 210, two distinct worship services, this one and a great one at 10:30 as well, but one church. And then the zero is one, we've talked about this and tried to understand what it looks like then to have zero debt and the importance of that. And zero debt means paying off all of our existing mortgage that we've been paying off for 20 years, but still have about $600,000 left, paying that off, but then doing some other improvements and advancements and raising some money for mission. So we'll talk about what this campaign, this capital campaign that the elders are laying before you today, what that looks like and the why of that. But first I wanted to ask Kyle, as our campaign co-chair, because we have a team that has been helping us to understand, like, how do we do this? How do we proceed through this? How do we just share that vision with all of us as a church because we're in this together? Like, why are you excited about that? Why did you say yes to being part of that? Let's talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, thanks, Mark. So as Mark said, I'm Kyle Whipple. I generally go in the second service, and so it's good to see the other side of the church. But I think a few things in it. When we hear things from ministry leaders at the church, there's kind of that idea of, well, they're supposed to say that, they're the leader of the church. So as a lay person who is not on staff, and especially being on stage, I help with the music in the second service. Just more and more, especially since COVID, we look out and what used to feel like I knew almost everybody, or at least I'd seen them before, more and more my wife and I, Amy, have mentioned, I don't know half of the people that are there. And it's because there's a lot of new faces coming to Trinity. And I think that's huge because it changes a little bit of the fabric of who we are at the current moment. There's a lot of people trying to discover more and more about their faith. They've had the doors open to them, whether it's through food pantry or youth ministry or children's ministry or the preschool that's reached so many here. And so on the inside of the pamphlet here, I love this. It says over 70 new families have visited and filled out a Connect card since in 2022. We've had 40 new members in 2022. Almost 1,800 families received food pantry goods in 2022. From an international standpoint, 472 people served our neighbors in need through outreach opportunities in 2022, whether that was here, the food pantry, the different places that we traveled, whether it was jars and the ripple effect of the community they have, or our students going to Guatemala, or you can fill in the blank with the amount of missionaries that we've been able to support that reach out across the world. And I think the more and more when we look at that, there's been this need to say we want to do ministry more effectively. And when Tony Melnerick approached me and said, hey, we're doing this financial campaign, I could not get out of the conversation as quick as possible. I'm not a big fan of churches and financial campaigns, and I would go as far as saying it makes my stomach squirm. But as Tony started to lay out some of that vision of why, I just thought this is a great opportunity. It's a great opportunity to do what Trinity is already doing, but do it more effectively, and I think do it more efficiently. Some of the numbers that float around, there's about $150,000 a year that goes towards paying debt. And our thought is if we can collectively come together as a body of Christ and the body here and the family at Trinity and pay some of those things off, that frees up $150,000 that we can go towards different ministries, whether it's here or in our neighborhoods or internationally. And so we're really excited to be a part of that. For me, I think a major part of it was my family has been here since the beginning. Rich and Karen Whipple are my parents. They left Ward Church, Old Ward Church in Livonia, to come out to the middle of nowhere and start this community of faith. I still feel like we're in the middle of nowhere, but it's been something that's always been a part of my life. And so I grew up going to Pioneer Clubs. That's what they called the, I guess, what is now Awana. And then I was in the middle school youth group here. I think my earliest recollection of having a recognition of faith was when I was at Vacation Bible School. And they brought me on the side of the church house, which was a building that we donated, I think.
We burned it.
It was a practice exercise for the local fire department. But that's where all the youth stuff happened. And I remember going on the side of that church house and them talking to me about salvation. And even as a 7-year-old or whatever it was, I just remember feeling, I know for a fact that this is what I believe. That makes sense. I'm a sinner and Jesus is the answer to my sin problem. And so the ministries that happen at a very young age and through youth really set a platform for people growing in their faith through the rest of their life. And so I left in high school and went to a different church for youth group, but I would come back, and this was always my family. And so whether it was loved ones' funerals or weddings or graduation parties or fill in the blank, this was always somewhere that my young family and I, when we moved away to Philadelphia, came back to, and it was always a stable thing in my life. And there's not many things that I can look back to in my own life and point out that's extremely stable all the way through. And so when we came back almost 13 years ago, we stayed at Trinity as more of a stopgap, and we've never left. And before we were married, I was here for a summer. I was a youth group leader, and since I've been back, I've been part of a small group. I've been part of the worship arts ministry. I've helped out at Food Pantry a few times, and the reason that I do these things and that I think involvement is important is because I think God uses our involvement in the body of Christ here to allow the work of the Spirit to continue to bring people together. And so the reason that I do small groups, the reason that I go out to lunch with Scotty or touch base with Mark about life is because I think other people's vulnerability has increased my own. And the help that other people have given me has caused me to be able to reach out to others and open up. And I think the more and more we can do that effectively, that we can be a part of what's going on. The ministry fair is later. If you can physically be a part of what's going on here, I think God will do some amazing things in your life through that. But it also connects us. And I think part of the giving campaign, when I saw this, is I saw this is an opportunity to further what's already going on here. And I think that's something special. It's not a big thermometer in the back filling up with a dollar amount so that we can build some massive building. It's how do we more effectively use the resources that we already have here, whether it's physically in ourselves or it's financially through what God's provided for us, to give to the ministry here and to see what God's going to do.
Awesome. Thank you for sharing that. Can I ask you to grab this little bifold All Generations campaign thing that was on your seat and look at the inside left, and I'll just walk you through in 2 minutes the overview of the ask and what's going into this. Somebody asked me before the service, is there a time for questions? And we're not going to have an open time for questions today. But if you have any questions at all, get a hold of Tony Molnarek, get a hold of myself, Kyle, somebody that's on the campaign chair team, and we'll be able to just talk through anything that you want. We're an open book. But imagine the impact, and I've got some slides for this. We talk about 210. So zero is the zero debt, and I'll give you some rough numbers. The overall campaign of the amount of money that we're asking all of us to sacrificially give toward over the next 2 years, because this is a 2-year commitment, is $1.5 million. $600,000 of that goes to pay off the existing debt. And as Kyle mentioned, that roughly equates to about $150,000 every single year that we're paying toward that debt to service that. Our debt comes due next September. It has a higher interest rate now, just like a lot of your homes might if you're trying to buy a home. So we'd like to not have to pay higher interest rates. $600,000 will go toward paying off the entire debt, having a great mortgage burning service, those sorts of things. $400,000 is to help continue the improvements in the building. We're investing in people, not the building, but the building facilitates ministry to people. So $400,000 will go toward things in this room, things in the worship, the Family Life Worship Center, things in our children's ministry area, to advance security, to advance sound, lights, all the sorts of things like that. So $400,000, we've got a long list of the things that we'd like to spend on those. $300,000 is really upgrades and maintenance for the building. It's things like air conditioners and so on like that, that are needed in a growing building, in an aging building, I should say. So $300,000 there. $200,000 is really important to us because of who we are as a church, that we don't do things just for ourselves, that we're giving away. So $200,000 is actually geared towards setting aside for our mission partners so that they can help people see the gospel, see who Jesus is, help with children in pain and poverty. There's some different ways that our mission partners do this. So the overall ask is $1.5 million. We can do this together as we gather. I wanted Kyle to share a couple other thoughts too as campaign chair, maybe if you haven't shared already, about just how you feel about how we process this and what that looks like.
Yeah, I think it's difficult. And so personal stories, I think the idea that we're asking is for people to participate. It's really easy in a situation like this to hear, okay, Mark joked around that somebody told him, hey, you did a really good job in that. I almost didn't feel your hand in my pocket, right? And I think that's what often comes forward with financial campaigns in churches is that, oh boy, they want our money again. To me, the bigger idea, again, is participation. It's about being a part of it. And I love some of our founding members that were here. We used to meet in Isbister Church on Canton Center, just south of Ann Arbor Road. That's where Trinity started when we didn't have a building. One of the pictures that was up earlier showed Dr. Moore, our founding pastor, was digging the shovel in the ground at our groundbreaking ceremony. If they expanded that picture, myself and Marge Meixner, who used to be at Hathaway, are sitting in the dirt playing in front of that podium. And so when I talk about being a part of things from the beginning, it means a lot. And I love that Robin Lowy had mentioned, I hope I'm not taking away a future interview, but
<It's all good. laughs>
Robin Lowy, who was here from the beginning one time, was passionately talking to a group of us. And she said, when we first started at Trinity, if we wanted there to be a building, if we wanted there to be a ministry, if we wanted there to be fill in the blank, she said, it was on us. She said, there wasn't a group of people to look at and go, I hope they fund it. And so she said, we sacrificed in the beginning because we really believed in what was going on and being a part of the body here. And that's what I love. She said, what I don't want people to miss out on is the fact that it's not about giving. It's about being a participant. And so for some people, that's going to look like, as maybe a kid, that's going to be $5. You're going to sacrifice part of your allowance. For somebody, that might be $500. For some, it might be $1 million. I don't know what that looks like. But what we're asking for people to do over the next 2 years is just provide a commitment to say, hey, I want to sacrificially step out. All right, I want to figure out where I can pare back maybe in our lives to be a part of what's going on there. But there's also a step out of faith of, hey, I really feel like God is calling us to be part of this giving, and I don't know where it's going to come from. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, we always like to talk about the part that says trust in the Lord with all your heart, but it also says lean not on your own understanding. And I think sometimes if we feel God is calling us to do something, we can step out in faith and not lean out on our own understanding. And so our hope is that you would participate in this as part of the family of God and part of the family of Trinity, but that's hard. My oldest daughter graduated in June. She just left for college 3 weeks ago. Half of my marriage is completely wrecked and emotional. The other half is trying to stay stable with the oldest kid gone. We have 5 kids. We had one that we planned against, but God had different stories. Right, so we have one in college, one in high school, one in middle school, one in elementary, and one in preschool here at Trinity. Right, that's a stretch. Some of you are like, that guy's crazy. I'm not listening to him anymore.
Pray for you.
That might be true. We took my daughter's car in before she left for college. The mechanic, who I trust greatly, was like, yeah, you shouldn't drive that anymore. And I said, like, not at all, or just like locally? He goes, you shouldn't drive it at all. And he said, it's not worth fixing. So all of a sudden, we're in this position where we're trying to pay for school. We're trying to take care of other things. And now we need another car for my daughter, right? And my son. I don't know what these things are going to look like. Financially, things are not always easy, right? I work in financial services, and I work with planning for retirement for people. And I've seen how hard it is to go into retirement saddled with debt. I've seen how hard it is for people to maintain living expenses when emergencies come up. I can fill in the blank. But God's not necessarily asking us, and we're not asking you right now to say, hey, I can figure this out. This is going to work. Like, we can peel off an extra X amount of money. What we're asking you to do is figure out, what is sacrificial giving mean? And if you step out in faith and make that commitment, I understand we don't know what's going to happen in 2 years. 2 years from now, God may bless you more than you ever imagined, and you can give more than what you committed to. And for some of you, you may make that commitment and life may happen, and you might realize, hey, we can't be a part of it like we wanted to, and that's okay. So what we don't want is pressure and guilt. What we want is an excitement to be a part of what's going on and realize it's not, hey, I hope they are able to do this. It's more, hey, I hope we're able to do this. And then we can see collectively as the body of Christ here and as a family, where's the Lord taking us? And that's one of the reasons why I'm really excited about it, is I thought this was much bigger than how do we get a big new shiny building, right? How do we get more sound equipment so that the band sounds better in the second service, or that the organ sounds even more magnificent than it does now? It's just more about doing what we're already doing, but I think doing it more prudently. And that's one of the things I'm excited about. So the commitment card here, you can fill it out. You don't have to wait. What we're asking is that people are able to come together in prayer, talk together as a family or a friend or whoever you talk to, and that by October 1st, that we're able to have our commitment cards in to say, hey, I believe that over the next 2 years that we can be a part of this by providing X. And we're asking God to be a part of that and to bless us when we step out in faith. But for some of you that are like, hey, forget it, I want to give now, you can already go online. You can either give or you can give your commitment card. There's a link on the website.
First page.
First page of the website. I should have asked that before we started.
That's all good.
Sorry. But we are set up online if that's something that you'd like to do now. But we just think it's such a great opportunity to kind of launch us into that next place and see what God's going to do with the new life and the new families and the new things that are going on here at Trinity.
That's awesome. So what we did over the summer is we did have a couple of gatherings, and we invited all of the elders of our church, all the deacons of our church, all the staff of our church, and a number of others that we felt like would be really excited to be part of an initial lead gift team that would say, we want to, before the whole church knows about it and they knew about this day, we'd like to make a commitment that really gets things rolling and to help the church see this is possible. And so as we all gathered together, we shared some of the same sort of things. We shared the why and the what, the how much, what we're doing, how this would all roll out. We gave them the same commitment card, and we asked, would you consider giving or making a pledge that would be over the next 2 years? A sacrificial gift for one person is way different than a sacrificial gift for another person. We're not asking for equal amounts. We're asking for equal sacrifice, that each one of us would consider doing that. Denise and I spent quite a bit of time in prayer and dialogue about what our commitment would be, and we made a gift that would pinch for us because we wanted it to be, and nobody will know how much that is, but we wanted that to be a model because we're doing this as well. We love this church. We're part of this church. We want to be part of the future of this church. And so what's really cool is $1.5 million is a whole lot of money. Amen? $1.5 million is a lot of money. As we gathered together all of the leaders and early investors in our church, I was blown away that some of the initial gifts started to roll in and have continued to come in, and the initial pledges. So of that $1.5 million, today I can say, as of Friday, I know it's even more today, but as of Friday, the amount that's been pledged toward this $1.5 million is $1,043,000. And that's come in with very large gifts and much more modest gifts, but it's come in with sacrificial gifts. So again, as Kyle mentioned, we'll talk about this just again at the end, but my hope is that every person in our church would participate. And it might mean over the next couple years that you could commit to $50 or $500 or $5,000 or $50,000. We've had gifts far north of that, which is amazing. But your gift, your sacrificial gift just says, I love this church, I want to be part of this, and I want to make my own contribution toward this campaign. And so God is good, isn't he? God is good. That's all we're going to say for now, but I'm going to pray for us. And we're going to open up God's word together and continue just to worship him. So, Father, man, I'm so thankful for this church, for your grace to us, for the generosity that you have caused your people to have over the years, not just for this campaign, but for years and years. People have invested in the kingdom of God in this community, invested in the lives of people in this community. And I pray that you would continue to walk before us, to help us to be faithful to you, faithful to Christ, proclaiming your word and the gospel in this community so that people far and wide would come alive in Jesus and grow in Jesus and change the world with Jesus. We're thankful in his name. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome to Trinity. We are so happy to have you today. It's fall kickoff, and we are excited for all of the wonderful things happening today. If you're new or a guest, we would love for you to fill out that Connect card that's in your bulletin this morning. Fill that out and stop by the Connect desk on your way out and turn that in. We have a free gift for you. We cannot wait to meet you. You can also grab a hot fudge sundae on your way out today for our ministry fair and browse all of the tables. It's going to be a great morning. We have so many amazing things happening this fall that it's just way too much for me to announce this morning. So I've invited my friend Rob to do it for me. Hey, Taylor Swift fans, check this out.
It feels like the perfect day to have an ice cream sundae. After all, it's Sunday. I like mint chocolate chip. But there's a ministry fair after service today. You can go talk to the Plymouth Events Outreach team, have some ice cream. It's going to be a great time. And if you talk to the Plymouth Events Outreach team, you can decorate a scarecrow in the Plymouth Park. Oh, they do scarecrows there for those of you that don't know. Yeah, midweek begins this week. It's every Wednesday. There's Awana, which doesn't mean they're playing Moana. It's different. Oh, yeah. There's dinner once a month. First dinner's this week. It's $5. Uh-oh, I don't know about thee, but I'm a Trinity. If Pastor Mark's not preaching, then it's David Torrey. You don't know about me, but what you cannot see is I love singing about, I love singing about Trinity. For the ladies, there's a women's Bible study is doing gospel on the ground. How'd the gospel get on the ground? Who dropped it on the ground? Somebody pick it up. There's also a bonfire and a hayride on September 29th at Three Cedars Farm. That's right. If you're at a different farm, that's not right. Second, I got to turn the page. And for the teenagers, there's TSM Olympics where you compete. And there's Alpha Sunday mornings, that's where you can ask all the biggest questions in your life, like who is God and why do pimples exist? Uh-oh, I don't know about thee, but here at Trinity, there's also activities for all the retirees. So come to prime time and see how fun old age can be. And this almost concludes the Trinity announcements. Trinity, yeah. And for the college college kids. There is a retreat, yeah, for the college kids. Who knows who you'll meet, yeah, for the college kids. Get up on your feet, get up on your feet. You gotta go to the retreat. You, I feel in 22. Everything will be alright if you keep me next to you. Oh, sorry, I got a little carried away there.
Thanks, Rob, for using your gifts for Jesus and for our announcements this morning. If you would like to give toward any of our ministries this morning, you can do so very easily by going to our app or our website, or you can stop at our giving boxes in the gathering spaces. Thank you so much. Now we're going to get into our new sermon series. We are a church that is for all generations, for one kingdom, and that's Jesus' kingdom.
Good morning, church. How do you follow that? My name is Wanda Sands. I've been attending Trinity since, I believe, January of 2017, along with my husband, Michael, and our two kids, Micah and Maya. We serve in ministries, the TSM ministries, and also the worship ministry. Today's scripture reading is coming from Matthew chapter 13, verses 44 through 46. Follow along with me. The kingdom of heaven is like hidden treasure in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. This is the word of God. Can we all stand, please?
Welcome, Trinity, to a most special and historic four-week sermon series and an all-church focus as we launch a new two-year capital campaign that we're calling All Generations for One Kingdom. Psalm 100 tells us that the Lord is good and His love endures forever, that His faithfulness continues through all generations. And so each Sunday, we're going to hear from all generations as we worship and focus on the one kingdom of Jesus that rules and reigns over all generations at Trinity. Jesus invites each one of us to be his disciples and to learn about the beauty and the community and the legacy and the advance of his kingdom. And so I want to personally ask each of you to prayerfully consider what part you might play in this capital campaign and right now to prepare your heart to receive God's encouragement as we open up his word together. God's faithfulness continues through all generations.
Yes, it is weird to watch yourself on the screen. They made me do that. Whoever they are. Have you ever dreamed about finding buried treasure? Ever since I heard the story about pirates burying their golden doubloons in Treasure Island, or the story of Aladdin finding his magic lamp, I, like many of you, have dreamed about finding something of incredible value and having it just change your life. And there's a true story about this. 2023, this year, February, New York Times talked about a real-life discovery like this. A man named Arthur Clarke, 34 years old, in England, had just lost his dog to cancer. Super sad story. He's depressed. He's kind of walking through the grounds of his friend's farm, and had taken along his metal detector, which a hobby he had just picked up 6 months before. And as he's scanning the ground, he heard a loud beep and just was for sure that he had found an incredibly valuable pop can. And yet dug down and amazingly, a foot down under the ground on the land of his friend, he found this pendant and necklace that's up on the screen. And at first he thought it was just some costume jewelry, but then he picked it up and realized how heavy it was, how old it looked and how valuable it seemed. And so he took it to his friend and he showed him, and his friend recognized that it looked like something because he'd done a lot of history reading, something that maybe was from the time of King Henry VIII, 1500s. And the reason that he thought that is, as he looked at this heart shape and the pomegranate that's on the front of this was the symbol of Catherine, the first wife of Henry VIII, and the pomegranate, the ribbon that was on there, the H and the K, all of those things pointed to him that this might be something that was really valuable. And so by British law, if you find something in a field like that, you have to disclose it to the public figures, because museums have the right to buy it and pay the finders a fee for that. And so they took it to the museum, and the curator of the Museum of Natural History in Birmingham, England, saw this and held it in her hand, and she began to just shake because she recognized that this probably was legit. And they've shown that this is a 500-year-old legitimate pendant from the time of King Henry VIII, something that was given to his wife Catherine. And when they sell it, because it hasn't been sold yet, this will absolutely change the life of both the landowner and the person who found it. It's the stuff you dream of. And one of the things I love about that story is it reminds me of these two parables that Jesus told about the value of his kingdom and the value of finding his kingdom. And when I said that just now, that this parables and kingdom, those are two words that maybe are unfamiliar to us. And so I want to do a crash course for 1 second on the kingdom of God and parables. So the kingdom of God, or the equivalent phrase kingdom of heaven, they're used interchangeably depending on whether you're reading Matthew's gospel or Luke's gospel, is not, when you hear kingdom of heaven, don't think heaven, the place I go when I die. That's not what's meant when you read in Scripture kingdom of heaven or kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is a theme that starts way back in early in the Old Testament, that God controls all things. God is sovereign over the whole universe. God is king over the whole universe. And yet human beings don't often recognize that. Even though God rules and reigns over everything, the early humans, the first humans, rebelled against God. They walked away from God. They don't recognize the authority of God. And so all sorts of badness ensues, and we're part of that, part of the effects of sin. We see how messed up the world is around us all the time. There's wars, there's famines, there's all sorts of plagues and so on in the midst of goodness. And so the story of the Bible is that God the King promises that he will send his son, a savior, a Messiah, to be the king. And so Jesus comes on the scene, and he is the king. He is the promised hope of all of the Old Testament ways that they looked forward to redemption, to the rule and reign of God even on this planet. So Jesus is telling about this kingdom. And the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, is a complex concept, because entering into the kingdom in the biblical language is the equivalent of trusting in Jesus, of having faith. You become one of the people of the kingdom when you become part of the church. And so there's this odd mixture of think the rule and reign of God, it's following Jesus, it's discovering the beauty and joy of his rule and reign. It's following the way of Jesus. All those things are meant. It's this incredible concept. And so when Jesus talks about this incredible concept, to try to break it down, he uses little stories. They're called parables. And a parable is just a true-to-life story. It's not, most likely not a true life story like the story of Arthur Clarke that I just told you about. It's a story that uses elements of everyday life and things that people would know to be able to explain really deep spiritual truths. And so in Matthew 13, the passage that we read these two little parables from, Jesus is telling multiple parables in a rapid-fire fashion, not explaining them very much at the time, but each one of them is describing what the kingdom is like. The kingdom of God is like yeast in a little bit of dough. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed that grows and becomes this incredibly big tree. The kingdom of God is like a banquet. The kingdom of God is like a pearl of great price. The kingdom of God is like a treasure that's buried in the ground. And each one of these little snapshots are meant to evoke different aspects of the kingdom. And the two that you just heard read are meant to evoke the incredible value of the kingdom of God, of of, again, not heaven, not the value of heaven, the value of knowing Jesus, the value of knowing God's rule and reign, of following Jesus, of following God in this world, and seeing how that unfolds. And so that's what he means by the kingdom and by parables. And so let's look at those two parables just real quick, and just imagine yourself in the ancient world, and let me help you with that, because Jesus tells this first one in Matthew 13, 44 about buried treasure, and he says the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. This is literally the story that I told you almost at the beginning. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all that he had and bought that field. So you imagine a farm worker, hot sun beating down, he's pushing his plow, maybe followed by, you know, preceded by an ox, he's pushing his plow, and all of a sudden you hear clink, and you've hit something, and it doesn't sound like a rock, and so you start to dig around it a little bit, and this farmer digs down, and he realizes that he's broken a clay jar, and he looks inside the clay jar, and he sees all this gold. He sees coins that have been maybe buried there for dozens of years, maybe generations. Who knows what it is? And he knows that the law of the land of that day is if you lift that out, it belongs to the person who owns the land. And so what does he do? He leaves it in the ground, which is what he should do. And he buries it back over again because he realizes that this is a treasure that he could actually have. And so he goes away and he goes back to his hometown and he talks to his friends. He talks to his family. He says, look, I've got the deal of a lifetime. Can you loan me $20? Can you give me $100? Can you give me $1,000? Can you? He gathers everything that he owns, all that he can get from other people. And he goes back and he offers it in a real estate transaction, hoping against hope that the person will take the amount of money that he has for this field. And unbelievably, the person says yes. And he now owns the land. He owns the treasure. And you can just imagine the joy. If that was you, you'd be like, yes! Hello, I just won the lotto. And then Jesus tells a second story. And it's very similar to the first story. This time, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. This person knows the deal. They know what fine pearls look like. And when he found one of great value, he went away, sold everything he had, and he bought it. Again, think of it in modern terms. There are so many different reality TV shows that are like this. Antique Roadshow, American Pickers, all those sorts of things. Maybe you watch some of those. This person is out doing some garage saling, looking for bargains. And they're it's the end of a day. They know that it's 11 o'clock in the morning. All the good stuff is gone, and they pull up to the last garage sale that they're going to go to that day, and they just think, well, maybe. And so they park the car, they walk out there, and this person walks up at the jewelry that's laying there and immediately sees something that they know must be valuable. And they pick up this pearl pendant, and they begin to look at it and realize this actually is probably worth tens of thousands of dollars. And so if you were in that situation, you would gingerly go over to the person that's running the garage sale and say, how much do you want for this? And the woman comes to you and she says, because she knows she's got something valuable, but she has no clue what it really is worth. And she says, $100. I won't take anything less. And in your heart, you're thinking, ah. And you check your wallet and you have $20 and you have no Venmo because you're my age. And if you don't know what Venmo is, it's because you're older than me. So he leaves, hoping against hope that he'll still be there when he gets back, and runs to the ATM, pulls out all the money he has, and comes back, and it's at the end of the garage sale, and hopes against hope that this pearl is still there, and it is. And they offer that $100, and they take it, and they think to themselves, yes! Which is exactly what you would think. See, this is what Jesus is getting across, this emotion of the value of the kingdom. That's the main point of these two parables, is the incredible value of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of God is so valuable, it's worth giving up everything for. The message of the parable is not God wants you to be rich, okay? That's not the message of the parable. The message of the parable is not it's okay to spend your whole life looking for hidden treasure and buying as many lottery tickets as you can until you hit the big one. That's not the message of this parable. The message of this parable is primarily that the value of the kingdom of God is worth giving everything up for. The gain is worth the pain. There is nothing better than spending your life for the kingdom of heaven, Jesus says. Because ultimately, the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, entering into his life, entering into him is the most valuable thing that you'll ever have. And you'll experience the joy that this person experienced who found it. The kingdom of heaven is worth dying for. It's worth living for. God wants to give it to us, though. That's the incredible paradox of this. Is that this kingdom of heaven, God's rule and reign in this universe, is right there hidden in plain sight in our world, and yet most people never see it. And yet for those who are drawn to it, who God leads to his treasure, the one beautiful treasure that we can have, when we grasp it, when we look, get hold of it, we recognize the surpassing value of the kingdom in our life. The kingdom of God is so valuable, it's worth giving up everything that we have for. The second thing you learn from this parable is that the treasure that they find is intimately connected with the presence of Jesus. And it's something, we look at this and realize that the kingdom of heaven is the one great treasure. And again, that doesn't mean that going to heaven when we die is the one great treasure. The kingdom of God ultimately is God's presence in our life, God's presence in this world, his rule and his reign literally over us, in us, through us. And where do we see God's presence manifest in this world in the most full and complete way? It's in Jesus. That's what the story of the gospel and the incarnation of Jesus is all about, that Jesus himself is the living, ongoing, inbreaking presence of God. He is with us. He is for us. He is transforming us. He is working through us. The Apostle Paul understood this really clearly, the surpassing value of a relationship with Jesus. A couple different places are really fascinating. Philippians 3:8, he writes this, "I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Jesus Christ my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things." And then he says there's joy in the discovery of Jesus Christ in Colossians 2:3, "Jesus Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." See, when we recognize in this life the presence of our Savior with us and through us, transforming us, that makes all the difference. This treasure that we discover is trusting Jesus, knowing him in our life. And then third, as a result of that, lives are changed. Lives are transformed. I could say it this way, and this maybe is the big idea for the whole sermon. The beauty of the kingdom is the changed lives of people. You think about these two men who found those treasures, who gave up everything for them, and now they possess the treasure. And if that treasure is really God's presence, his rule, his reign, the presence of Jesus, the one thing that strikes me about that story is they would do anything for it. Their lives were changed. Like you don't walk away from that day if you're these men in the story and have your life just be the same. Your life was completely transformed. And that's true of us. When we come to know Jesus, when we place our faith in him, he begins this process of transforming everything about us. He helps us to see the sin that's going on in our life, to repent of that sin, to begin to grow in him, to join together with a community of believers in him, and we rub shoulders with each other, and we learn from each other, we grow from each other, we challenge each other, we become part of this new thing, this inbreaking of God's kingdom, this outpost of the kingdom and rule and reign of God in our community. We become part of that. It changes us from the inside out. So two stories, two lives forever changed by the discovery of the true treasure of Jesus. Jesus and his kingdom. I love those stories. Let me, for a moment, tell you a little bit about a church that knew the value of the kingdom and invested in what became us. 44 years ago, Kyle shared this a little bit in his testimony, but 44 years ago, the leaders of Ward Church in Livonia recognized that God's kingdom was worth investing in, and investing in with their time and their treasure and their talent. And so in early 1978, that church had grown to over 3,000 people, and they had a heart to plant a new church in the rapidly growing town of Plymouth, Michigan, a church that would prioritize evangelism and teaching of the Bible and missions. And they began meeting at Trinity Chapel, March 18th, 1979, in the auditorium at Isbister Elementary. And this is a picture from the very first service in 1979 in that auditorium, where they began to worship. 40 families from Ward came and were worshiping together, but they outgrew that space rapidly. Within a year, they were 104 families. And in June of 1980, we became what's called a particular church. In other words, we're on our own. And they found 40 acres of property that we sit on today here at Godfredson and Ann Arbor Road in an area that surely, they thought, within 10 years will be brimming with subdivisions. As you can see, it is, right? They bought that land for $300,000. It included a house and a fruit stand. That $300,000 in inflation-adjusted money today would be $1.4 million. They bought that. Here's a picture of the first worship service in front of the fruit stand where Bill Moore, our founding pastor, is preaching, and the choir is behind. The first annual report, I have it in my hand, lists the 25 members of the choir that started. 7 of those members are still here, right? Rich and Karen Whipple, Kyle's mom and dad, the Hathaways, the Lowys, and Marty Lefevre were part of that original choir. 7 of those 25 are still around. They preached God's word and began to grow. But that I have a bunch of different archives. This is awesome. This is the first annual report for our church. And this is a church that has grown and has a magnificent facility, everything else, but it's always been about people. And I want to prove that to you by reading from the back page of the first annual report, just an excerpt about who we are. This is what we said about ourselves, and by God's grace, I 100% believe that this is still true. I want to put these words up on the screen for you. Here, they call it a spiritual blueprint for Trinity Presbyterian Church, and here's how it reads. People loving people, people helping people, people learning to be the people of God. How would you define a church? Trinity is a church where people are loving and helping and learning. Trinity is a church based on the Bible. We will look to the Bible, God's word, as our basis for teaching and preaching faith and life. Trinity is a church centered on Christ. Christ shall be proclaimed as the only means of our salvation, the focal point of our worship, the only source of genuine spiritual life and growth. And third, Trinity focuses on people. We believe our calling is to help meet the needs of people with the inexhaustible resources of God. And it goes on. And again, by God's grace, those are still true of us. I 100% believe that. That is awesome. Bible-focused, centered on Christ, and focused on people. And that's still our calling. And we're going to go 10 minutes long today, and I hope that you'll give us some grace on that, because we shot an interview with two of our founding couples of our church, and I wanted them to, we just asked them a bunch of questions, we edited it down, but I wanted you to hear firsthand from the Lowys and the Hathaways about some of the things that they've experienced over the years related to the changed lives of people and what they think about this upcoming capital campaign, because they've been early contributors to it. So let's listen and just enjoy this great couple.
Share with us some of your first highlights, first things that come to mind when you think of Trinity Church 44 years ago. How were the generations involved serving Christ's kingdom?
We did everything. There were a small handful of us, and we did everything from setting up cribs and playpens for the nursery to chairs, to handing out programs, collecting offerings, running up and singing in the choir, all 9 to 12 of us, and then tearing it all down.
Right, and we started with many generations. It wasn't just all of us that were in our 20s with babies. And we had people who were older than we were. We thought they were very old. They were probably in their 50s.
That was an intentional choice that the elders and the staff made to get the church to build that cohesiveness.
I think we were very blessed with the people that came with us, because
yes,
they were just wonderful mentors, wonderful role models, and they were, you could tell how excited they were that they were part of it.
What do you remember about changed lives early on in Trinity's days? When I say changed lives and the kingdom of God, what comes to mind?
Early on, we had testimonies regularly from people whose lives had been changed by Christ, either at Trinity and because of Trinity or because just wanting to give their testimony. We did it regularly. And also we had several rows of kids that would come from University of Michigan. Mm-hmm. And a lot of those kids come back, raise their family here. Mm-hmm. And they also, several of them became missionaries to various places.
Yeah, and because, you know, Robin and I were fairly new Christians, I think we've been Christian, for a couple of years, mm-hmm. probably. So we were still learning. So Bill Moore, you know, the way he opened up the scriptures, and I mean, it's amazing how much, you know, we learned from his preaching and we continue to learn now.
This church has always had a family feel from everybody. Somebody remarked to me just the other 2 weeks ago, standing outside the Family Life Center, the gathering space, and it was after the service, and there were probably 60 people, and they were all standing around talking with each other after the service. And somebody said, this is what Trinity is all about. People are not looking to get out of here at 11:30 or 12 o'clock and get out and go do what they were doing on Sunday. Look at all these people standing around, talking with each other and enjoying each other's company. And that to me is a sign of a healthy, spirit-filled church when the people that are here genuinely love each other and want to spend time with each other and pray for each other and be concerned for each other. And I think that's always been a hallmark of this church. We've let the Spirit work through us to do that. Mm.
Looking ahead in the life of the church, in September of 2024, our mortgage comes due from that 2001 Family Life Center build. So the bank will either refinance at that point at interest rates what they're at, or we have the option to, you know, pay off as much as we can. What does it mean to you all to think back 44 years of history? What if you could have known that it's possible in 2023 or 2024 the church would be debt-free and be able to fund more ministry instead of paying a local bank? What does that mean to you all as people who have been here giving, serving, growing in Christ for so long?
So for me, that's really important that that debt isn't something hanging over our heads, precluding us from, you know, doing more ministries or reaching more people. So to me, that is a very important step, I think, that we need to take, and we've gotten to a certain size that we should be able to accomplish that.
Yeah, the church is not a building, it's the people in it. So we don't want to be wasting or spending our money on a building, on bricks and mortar. We want to invest in people.
The more that we can have our resources spent on missions or outreach programs, the better.
It's engraved on our building out here on the sanctuary when this was first built, a scripture reference from the Gospel of Matthew, where Jesus says, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Mm. How have you seen Christ build his church here? And I see you're getting emotional, so why don't you share first?
Well, I just think, sometimes you look at the amount and you think, that's a monumental amount. And when we started Trinity, we were young families and, trying to learn how to tithe and then give up and beyond was pretty mind-boggling for, young families. But it was a walk in faith that I felt like the entire congregation at the time participated. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the key, that all of us participate no matter what the dollar value is. It's not about that. It's about being part of a group.
That's beautiful.
Right.
That's the beauty of the kingdom, that everyone can participate in God's kingdom in so many ways with their gifts, time, talent, treasures.
Right.
And you all did that for 44 years plus. Let's keep going, right?
I love those guys. I love their story. I love the way that they bridge our past and our present and our future together. I love how each one of them invested their time, their talent, and their treasure and continue to do that in their church family. I'll show you one more picture before we go, and this helps you to understand maybe why this is so personal for me, why I so strongly believe in this church and what God's doing here. It's a picture from one of our early trips to Central Detroit Christian, working in a backyard. This is the mission that we've had over the years. And what I love about this picture is on the left, I see a young Becca Smith, Daryl Piper's daughter, who's in ministry today. This was early high school for her. The young guy in the white t-shirt is Mark Pugh. He's a policeman in our community, raising his family here at this church. And for me personally, what I love is the young lady in the green t-shirt holding up her muscles like this is my daughter, Rachel. And I know for a fact that God used that day to help cement her relationship with Christ, to be able to be a young lady that's gone on to med school and to serve in the area of rehabilitation and serve young people at a respirator-dependent camp and just loves the Lord, walking with her husband with the Lord today. And one of the reasons is that this church invested in people, and this church has known the value of the kingdom of God and changed lives. And I want that to continue. I want that to be true for you and for your families and for your grandkids. I want us to be able to do that. And so why are we doing this campaign? Ultimately, it's because we believe that the beauty of the kingdom is the changed lives of people. And when we pay off our debt, we're able to do more ministry. When we fix up our building, make our building more awesome and more usable, it helps us to do more of what God's called us to do, which was to share the gospel of Christ and to see people come alive with him and grow with him and change the world with him. And that's why I'm a big fan of what we're doing. So join with me in prayer as we close. Father, your faithfulness is amazing. You have been so faithful to us generation after generation after generation. Many who invested in your kingdom in the early days of this church are now with you, and they're experiencing glory, and they're experiencing your presence in a more full and profound way than we could ever imagine. And yet we also pray and believe that there are generations that will come after us who also will follow Christ because of the ministry of this church that you've placed in this community, an outpost of your kingdom. And so help us as your people to be part of that, to continue to grow in that. And if it's possible, help us to contribute to the campaign that will help this financially. But mostly, God, I just ask for your grace and your mercy and your peace to be upon us each day. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Let's stand and sing this last song about God's faithfulness. If you need to go and get kids or whatever, you know, you can do that. We're a few minutes late. But let's stand and sing and proclaim God's faithfulness to us and to all generations. Amen. Ooh. As you go today, remember the ministry fair, ice cream down at the other end of the building. Take those commit cards. Pray over those. Give those to us, if you could, before October 1st, or bring them on October 1st. We'll have a great service together. And just because God has a funny sense of humor, Tony just told me, apparently he wanted to give us an illustration of the need for some finances. We've been wrestling with our generator all week. The bathrooms and water at the new end of the building are kaput this morning. And so if you need to use some of those facilities, use them here before you go down to the other end. God, I can't believe it. It's so funny. So in Matthew, let me give you this benediction, this blessing. Matthew 6 records the time where Jesus said, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Your heart follows your treasure. And so hear these words. May Jesus be your treasure. May your heart belong fully to him. May you find incredible joy in your ongoing discovery of the riches of Christ. Amen and amen.